It's a fine day. People open windows. They leave their houses just for a short walk.
Just for a short walk.
It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow. It's going to be a fine night tonight. It's going to be a fine day tomorrow. Tomorrow, 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 tomorrow,
Man, I really love that song. All right, folks, we're back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with Will. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm good. I'm busy tallying votes for the NCAA, and we'll go from there.
And just let everybody know, I got Will worked up before we started recording, so he got all his political banter out, so we should be safe.
We'll see.
Let's talk about the basketball team here. I guess the outcome to me was a bit expected at Duke. I'm not sure if anybody was really surprised with how that ended up. I mean, they started out okay, and they were in the game, and then, you know, they just forgot how to play for some whatever reason. But I think the real – and we can nitpick these games, and I just don't think that's very fun. To me, and this is kind of what – you know, you've been saying all year and what a lot of people have been saying, this roster just doesn't have what it needs. Even if they're healthy, they don't have the players or the pieces to sustain any sort of successful season when your senior leadership is so inconsistent. And I think that's, you know, you watched the up and downs of Markell, and it just explains this team. Not saying he has to carry them, but the way he interacts and his body language really dictates how this team performs. And as soon as it gets down or as soon as it's bad, I mean, it's the rest of the guys start pressing, and it's just something is not right. And yeah, I just don't think they have the pieces. Even if they were healthy, I don't think we would be where we want to be.
Yeah. I mean, I just think we're the definition of streaky bubble team at this point. And, you know, it's, when he's down and the other guys are pressing, if they're pressing and hitting shots, it's fine, right? But if it's going to be a night where, you know, Devin is going to drive to the basket, but he's going to miss the layups, I mean, it's, you can just pretty much mark it down at that point. But I'm more concerned about the team seeming to just completely fall apart when they see a zone.
Yeah,
you know, I will say this, they were getting the shots that you'd be okay with. They were getting the open jump shots and the three pointers. It's just like none of them went in. And when that happened with Syracuse, right, we were like 44% from three, and that's why that game was, you know, just out of control primarily until the very end. It's just frustrating because you could see like that first half. It's like if K was dumb enough to not switch to the zone, that game was going a completely different direction. It might have tightened up once we got tired at the end of the game, but you know,
this team doesn't have the shooters. I think that's pretty much what it comes down to. Right? Like you go into a zone, you can't stretch a zone without guys that can hit shots consistently, and we're far from able to do that, you know, especially with Braxton and Andre hurt. You just don't have that guy that's even a threat out there. I mean, Markell's jumper looks terrible. CJ Bryce is just who knows, and Devin Daniels isn't consistent enough to stretch his own like that. And that's just what it is, man. I just don't think they have it. And when the shots aren't falling, the body language follows, and they really, I think it's maybe a confidence issue, but they get down on themselves. And it's, to me, it's pretty apparent that, you know, when they're feeling good And there was a couple possessions, a couple stretches in that game where like, yeah, that looks good, man. They're passing the ball. And, you know, it looked like they were in some sort of rhythm. And then as soon as that gets disrupted, they don't have that guy that's able to pull them through it. Like, settle down, make a clutch shot. I mean, not consistently. And I think it is what it is, but I think that's where we are right now. And that's kind of what I've expected from this team.
Yeah. I mean, you can't give up that many fast break dunks to Duke. You know, it's frustrating.
Yeah, at that point, they were just kind of...
Oh, yeah, I know. But
they kind of checked out.
I guess what I'm saying is, like, you just don't want to see it check out like that, I guess. Like, it doesn't give you confidence knowing that you have to win the next two games. And if this team doesn't understand that they need to win the next two games to get into the tournament, then they were, you know, kind of screwed from the get-go. But I guess the thing is, like, what you're saying, right, is... If Braxton Beverley's not hitting three-pointers, I mean, really, Jericho Helms is the best shooter.
Yeah.
And now we're talking, like, fractionally different at that point. But, you know, I mean, Andre – boy, I said it right. You know, he's sitting there taking, like, jumpers after games because he can't even, like – he can't even jump right now. I mean,
yeah.
It's hard to just – I don't know, man. I'm just saying, like, if we – can get perform. I mean, you need Devin Daniels is, I think, what it really comes down to. If you can get the points out of Devin, right, that can pull things through. And then these guys have got to figure out a way to disrupt the zone, to not just settle for the three. I mean, they know how to get the open three, I guess, but they need the guy at the point to just really heat up. I mean, cause if they hit five or six shots there against Duke's zone, I mean, that game might be over. Cause then they might go back to man. And then your dribble drive.
Yeah.
So,
you know, the Duke game especially, and I think this Duke team is similar to what State is. They don't have a bunch of shooters. And the reason they were able to sustain that second half is, you know, they made plays defensively that led to easy breakout dunks and that led to easy buckets. And State wasn't able to do that. So... That's about what I expected. You don't sweep Duke very often, but you know, this team, it's kind of what I've resigned to. This team just doesn't have the pieces that it needs. Yeah. You know, funny enough, well, not really funny. I was at a funeral during the Pitt game. Not funny. But I didn't get to watch the game, but as I was driving home, I was listening to the last, I don't know, 5 minutes or so. And so I didn't miss what. And I went back through Twitter and I, you know, just flipped through and it was the classic State roller coaster. I see everybody complaining, you know, the team wasn't doing well. Someone says, why is he doing this? Why is he doing that? And then, like, somehow they ended up winning that game. I don't even know how. But the last 5 minutes, like, oh, yeah, sounds like they're playing all right. And I went back. I was like, oh, maybe not. You know, I missed the whole, you know, 35 minutes of that game.
I was basically out running errands between this woodworking store and Home Depot. And I went from like, okay, the game's close to they like separated by 8 or 10 points. And I was like, I can't believe it. I can't with this team. And I actually wrote, I posted that on Twitter. And then I was like still driving. I put it on the radio just to check. And, you know, they were back within 5 or 6. And I was like, all right, I'm just going to listen to the game. And then I just basically stood in front of plywood for about 15 minutes. Just sweating so hard. you know, and then I was like, oh, this team's got heart at least. You know, that was good. I mean, Pitt also just looked like, I mean, they didn't like, they missed like 9 free throws or something. Like it was a lot of chicken sandwiches.
Yeah, I know. I hate that I didn't fire up the app on Monday. I completely forgot. Somebody put something out there. And it was just like, I'm over it. You know, we deserve better after all this time. And like, I get the frustration. You know, they're talking about 30 years of basically in-depth basketball. And it's like, yes, I get it. And I hate it. I hate what I'm about to say more than anything. I hate the wait till next year. Right. But what I responded with was the sunk cost fallacy. Right. It's just because all, you know, the 30 years prior to now has been shit, you know, that's not on Keats. You got to give him time to, you know, figure this out. because I think he is figuring it out. I think he's learning. And when this team plays well, it's really, you know, you can see the signs there. But, you know, why I say wait till next year is looking at what you're losing when you lose Markell, CJ Bryce, Danny Dixon, and Pat Andre. You're gaining Josh Hall, who's a 5-star small forward, Cam Hayes, 4-star point guard, Shaq Moore, point guard, Nick Farrar, power forward, and then Ebenezer Duwana, 3-star center, Thomas Allen, the 4-star shooting guard, who's the Nebraska transfer that everybody seems to forget about, sitting on the bench, and then Cebron, the 4-star point guard, who's sitting out now. So you're picking up instant depth. You got 7 guys there that are going to be able to play next year. And sure, you're losing Markell and CJ and your seniors, but you really haven't maxed out with them. And if Devin Daniels, this, what I think is the most important part of what Keats has to do is not lose anybody in the offseason. We've had years of attrition, so somebody is likely going to leave just based on the numbers. But if he keeps Funderburk and Daniels and then adds these other pieces and, you know, Jericho Helms and, you know, Braxton, I don't see those guys going anywhere. But if he's able to keep them and add these 7 pieces, this team should be a lot better, have a lot more depth, should have a lot more flexibility in what Keats wants to do. Now, your point guard position is going to be up in there. It's going to be, you know, Braxton probably rotating with Devin Daniels and, you know, mix in Cam Hayes and I don't know what Cebron's point guard, you know, skills are, but you're going to have a point guard by rotation. That's my biggest concern. But for the most part, you're adding a bunch of basketball players. Like, these guys are good basketball players, and that should be instant depth that should change what we're seeing now. That's my thoughts.
Yeah, I think the hope is that you don't have to bank on these guys, but – you know, if everyone's healthy and stays, it just gives you so much more to play with, right? Like, I mean, if you got Manny and DJ and one of them gets in foul trouble, then you've got Ebenezer there to put in the game. You know, I'm really interested to see, like, what Cebron does, if he really is, like, this pass-first kind of player, but can still be a little bit explosive. But more than anything, I think, you know, you're just going to probably see a better defensive team. I think you're going to have a lot of length and – I don't know. It's going to be hard to replace Markell. He's the most frustrating, but it's because he's so good that he's frustrating when you're not getting Markell. I don't know. I mean, it looks like a good squad from the depth perspective. I still think, like, you're in the middle of the ACC. I don't think any of these guys as freshmen are going to elevate the team per se, but I just wonder if, you know, Allen, Braxton, you know, Helms, like, you could have some really good shooters, especially if Allen is actually, legit, right? I mean, Andre was supposed to be a special 3-point shooter, and he's only about 34% this year. Right. I don't know. I'm excited. But, you know, guys, we could still get to the tournament. Let's not lose hope yet.
Yeah, I just think collectively, even though you're losing Markell and Bryce, collectively you're picking up a lot more basketball ability. You know, Markell is by a long shot, you know, long stretch, he's the most frustrating player because, like you said, you know how good he can be if he's engaged. Like, he is one of the best players in the league, in the country, if he's fully engaged. Even with his funky looking jump shot these days, nobody can stay in front of him. He can get to the basket. He can finish with his left. He can finish with his right. He does things that a lot of guys can't do, but he just doesn't do it consistently. And that's why it's so frustrating. So, yeah, I mean, I don't want to write off this year. Like, we told somebody last week, don't give up on this basketball team. There's still a chance. And, you know, but I just wanted to, like, put that in perspective. Like, I don't think this team has it, but I think Keats has got this thing moving where he wants to go now. I think he's kind of learned that. And, you know, he's also got the he's the 2021 kid, right? The Tre'Quavion Smith. Like, he's a guard, he's a scorer, he's shooting up the rankings. I mean, he's been committed to State for a while now. So Keats has figured out he's got to get guys that can play, and he's got to get guys that can fit his system from the high school level. And then he's got to keep this team together. I think that's his responsibility in the offseason.
I guess I would be surprised if anyone – there's no need for anyone to leave, I guess. Right? Like, Devin Daniels, I don't think, wants to transfer anywhere again, right, and risk to sit – I don't know if he'd have to risk sitting out again. Jericho –
or Braxton or DJ. I mean, they're
And they all get tons of minutes too. So, and they fit the system. Yeah. It's not like a Yurt 7, I guess, type situation where you think, okay, there's maybe a guy that's part of his, you know, his crew that thinks he can get something better. I mean, what's even happened to Yurt 7?
He's been killing it from what I've recall seeing. But yeah, there's no reason, and that's why, like, I wanted to clarify that too. I put that out there. Like, I don't expect anybody to transfer. There's no signs that anybody's unhappy, but it's just one of those things that happens, right? You don't see it coming, and for whatever reason, there's some kind of attrition. Keats has got to hold his team together. I think that's super important for the coming year.
He just needs to get Markell in the next two games to stop shooting three-pointers. Markell, I can't believe Markell's numbers this year. it's just terrible. He's at 26% right now for threes, and he's shot the most on the team. Of course, he's shot 153, which is 30 more than Braxton Beverly, and he's only made 40. Braxton's shot less and made more.
There's a definite disconnect from end of year last year, Markell, and what we've had this year.
You know what we're going to miss too from him? His rebounds. He's really good at getting rebounds. I don't know.
Our guards rebound well. CJ Bryce is our leading rebounder, I think.
He is actually. He's tied right now with DJ.
Yeah, I wonder if it's something to do with the system or the way the defensive roles. I'm not sure. I thought that was interesting, too. I think somebody pointed that out during the last game. D. Sanford asks, what are your expectations for the ACC tournament? You were just looking up the brackets. What are your expectations for the ACC tournament?
Well, you know, Georgia Tech is not going to be in it this year. I guess I'll know, like, once the brackets are actually fully set what my expectations are. But State will have a perfect opportunity to win the first game, probably playing Boston College, as it says right now, or if things get switched between them and Clemson, you could see them playing Miami. But that could also change, too. If I think there's actually still a path for UNC to get out of the opening day. So we know, of course, that will happen. So, right. Yeah, I mean, it looks like we're probably either going to be setting up against Florida State or Louisville. I'd rather take Louisville personally. I'd like another shot with them. I think we match up better with them, certainly than FSU. I don't want any part of that team right now. So I don't know. I mean, just as far as NC State's concerned, you've got to win this next game first, which is against Wake Forest, and then you've got to take care of business, because I think the committee unfairly is going to be looking for reasons to exclude State, and the only way you do that is just don't give them a reason. So, you know, if they win one of the matchups against Louisville or FSU, then I think they're locked in at that point, but you know, I think everything that they've needed from a bubble perspective has gone wrong the last few days as well. So, I don't know.
Yeah, I hadn't been following the bubble talk, but I've just seen enough people mention that everybody we needed to win
or to lose. I mean, from a blind resume, like if you look at that sheet that Giglio put together, that, I mean, if you cover the names, there's no reason you would select any of these teams, really. ahead of State.
Yeah.
State's Q1, Q2 record is just better than almost all of them. And I just think it's really ticky-tack to be like, oh, well, the Q3 losses. Like, who cares? The whole point of the NCAA tournament is to have a chance to keep advancing. And it's the teams that win the Q1, Q2s that I think have a better argument for doing so. And, I mean, don't get me started about the Big Ten. I think the Big Ten is going to, like, flame out like crazy in the tournament. So,
I wonder, did anybody last year apply the Q1, Q2 theory post-tournament and see how they did? Like, how does it correlate to the records? Somebody had to have done that.
I'm sure some salty-ass NC State fan would have done it. I know you guys were.
Right.
We're up in those Google Docs.
You mentioned Georgia Tech. And so Georgia Tech, I'm not, if everybody wasn't paying attention, self-imposed infractions or self-imposed penalties that is going to keep them out of the postseason, which essentially means they're not playing in the ACC tournament, which to me is a brilliant move because you're not making the NCAA tournament. So like, oh, we'll sit out the ACC tournament. We'll, you know, we'll take this postseason ban. If you're going to do it, that's the way to do it, right? Just sit out the ACC tournament. Nobody gives a crap.
I mean, I can't believe that that was like the satisfying conclusion there for the NCAA.
Right? So weird.
I mean, I would take now if it meant like nothing would happen. But I don't know.
Yeah. Mahesh asks, what will it take to make the NCAA tournament? Beat Wake, win one in the ACC tournament, and I think you're guaranteed. I think if you beat Wake and you lose one in the ACC tournament, then you're probably sweating.
Yeah. I would say you should be safe if you beat one in the ACC tournament, as long as none of the auto bid teams, like from those smaller conferences, right? As long as there's no upset there with like the, like with a legitimate good team, like, you know, as long as like a Houston or someone that I guess doesn't like flame out. I don't know. It's, I guess I just say that I was saying this earlier this week on the boards, like, there's no point in sweating the bubble right now. You'll figure out if it means something on, you know, Friday or Saturday of tournament week. I know no one wants to hear that right now. And some people enjoy it, and that's fine if you enjoy kind of getting into it. But people are like, oh, what should we do? Or how, you know, who are we rooting for? And I'm like, it doesn't matter. Like,
yeah.
I mean, State could just rip off like 3 wins in the tournament and then who cares, right? And then you were sitting here stressing out for a week over teams that you like don't care about. Who cares about Rhode Island? Cincinnati, you know, like don't. But anyways, that's it. I can't tell people not to be fans. So it's just my approach right now.
Yeah, I agree. Anything else basketball related? We play Wake 7 o'clock Friday.
Yeah. get ready for the zone. I'm sure we're going to see it.
One more basketball thing. I got a comment from Ed from LA. Sent me a message. Will asked you a great question. If State goes to NCAAs, what will make you happy for the 2020 season? Here's my answer. State wins in first round, loses to a high seed, close in second round. That would be something to build on. Yeah, I mean, and then he said losing in the NIT at home to Santa Clara or St. Mary's would be.
I knew that Ed couldn't leave it on a good note.
Yeah.
That's funny.
But yeah, I thought that was about where I would expect him. I think that's a fair expectation for this team. I mean, they could beat anybody, but they can lose to anybody at any time. You know, this
who
team
did he lose to, I guess, that first year? Was it like Providence or somebody? It was some team that was just like, oh, we're hard and NC State soft. And I remember that was the most infuriating thing to me ever because I was just like, fuck you. It's weird to get me that riled up like by a random team.
I think it was Providence. Yeah, I think it was.
You know, I hate the Big East. One of those. And Kevin Keats here. I'm just going back in time. Let's see here. Oh, this thing doesn't contain all the data. All right, no one cares about this.
Yeah. What? No one cares what got Will riled up 3 years ago. We get him riled up. this year. All right, so on to football.
Better, I think it was Seton Hall.
Better, bigger, better things.
Oh, Seton God, Hall, there you course. Go. All right, sorry. Yeah. Bigger, better things. Let's talk about a great sport, football.
Yeah, this is we're a football school and a football podcast. Spring practice started. There's been a lot of videos and hype videos and Penn State transfer. The question is, are you currently more optimistic about next season, more or less optimistic about next season? What do you think?
It's so dumb because there's like really no evidence other than these videos. I just feel like we're in good hands right now. I feel good. I just want to see what the spring game looks like. I want to see what the quarterback play looks like. It seems like, I don't know, Tim Beck just seems engaged, I guess. And that's not to say that Dez wasn't. It just, I don't know, they're sitting there practicing, you know, punch out drills on quarterbacks making runs. So that's probably a good thing.
Yeah, just putting the notes here. Spring game, since you texted me previously that they are actually, at least in theory, hyping up the spring game, right? They have plans for to make it an event like we've talked about. So somebody out there is listening. Thank you. You know, they need to start pushing it probably now and just make it a thing, you know, that everybody knows about. You can't not know about it. I think that's good that they're doing that. You know, as far as I'm going to say I'm more optimistic because it's a completely new coaching staff. I think you'll see new things, right? I don't think we're going to see the same old NC State that we've seen for the last 6-7 years. Not saying we're going to be, you know, blow everybody out of the water, but at least you're going to see new schemes. You're going to see new coaching styles. And a lot of the past frustrations, in theory, should not be there, right? So that makes me more optimistic.
I think we talked about it last week, but I was happy to see that Tim Beck basically acknowledging he is using his system and his terminology, and just so I think it's so that's why I want to see the spring game because I kind of just want to see how far did they progress, learning new terminology. You know, I mean, according to Tim Beck, it's, you know, a lot of the same plays in across the league, but it's all about how you call it and what the little intricacies are. So, you know, I think I've got more faith in the defense right now. It'll be interesting. You know, this is dumb, but I just want to see if like Josh Harris like gets in shape. That's going to be like an indicator for me. Because, you know, if you're going to have all your studs on defense and everyone's, you know, people are in shape, people are healthy, it's at least a better recipe for us than last year.
I really like what the potential you have at the linebacker position. If you have Peyton Wilson and Vi Jones and then mix in any of the other two or the other four in those two spots, I really think you have a much upgraded position there. I think that really is going to have
an impact. Charlie Wiles said an interesting thing about Vi Jones. He basically said like he is the equivalent of the defensive ends that they had at Virginia Tech. Yeah. So that's exciting to hear.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he's legit. Mahesh asked thoughts about the Tim Beck video. I actually did some homework and I pulled the audio from that video. So I'll play it now and we can listen to it. It's not going to have the same impact since it's...
They're not coming to Massahead. But...
yeah.
Good snap. Let's have a good day. We got to think. During chaos, we got to think.
Front, elbows in front. Protect the ball. Rhythm 3. Good, good. I'm going dynamo left and you like it. I want you to throw it without moving your feet. Just get it out. Now, yeah, I love that. Everybody's afraid to come to my side. They're afraid to come to my side.
Keep the ball away.
Clip.
Yeah, Yeah, so I think that, I mean, there's not much there, but what it tells me is that, like, the more you put these pieces together, like, the more intensity mm-hmm. you kind of see from him. And like you said, he's right in there mixing it up with very hands-on with the quarterbacks. And I think that's good. That's a good thing. So I liked it, man. I think there's a lot of stuff to look forward to. And I think that's why I'm probably a little bit more optimistic. I think we've had guys in position who haven't been in position before.
I think it's also good that they're, they're controlling the narrative. There's, you know, not much access for the media. It seems like all of the insider sites have basically said, take a grain of salt if you hear anything.
Yeah, that part's been crazy. There hasn't been really any reports come out. It's been a week now, and you really haven't heard anything. And I think that's – I'm guessing that's intentional, but it's different, right? Usually you start getting, oh, so-and-so, and here's the two deep that we, you know, expect and these sorts of things. But there really hasn't been anything that hasn't come out that hasn't been from – the official football accounts, social media.
I'm just waiting for the scrimmage stats to come out like Tom O'Brien used to do.
All right.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. I remember there were times he would release those. I was like, oh, my God, we're going to be the next Alabama. And then, you know, we got our team. So.
Oh, God. Long way to go. Keep everybody healthy. But I really like what they're putting out. The content they're putting out has been really good. The videos, you know, the social stuff. I mean, I think it's been real good. So I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it. We got some random questions here. Favorite pro sports team? Like, I don't really have any anymore. I've been so invested in college sports. I grew up a Yankees fan. I don't really watch baseball that much anymore. I kind of grew up a Bears fan because I jumped on the bandwagon in 85. But I don't really pull for them. I'd rather pull for the Chargers and Phillip Rivers or, you know, even the Panthers with all you Panthers.
Wait, has Phillip landed anywhere yet? Okay.
Not yet.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I grew up a Braves fan. And, you know, we were a Redskins household until the Panthers showed up. So I guess I would say Braves and Panthers, but yeah, I'm kind of the same way. I've really lost touch with professional sports, aside from the daily fantasy sports aspect of it. You know, right. So I'm probably more into the individual players, I think, now than I am into the teams. But
yeah,
you know, I always liked the Seahawks for some reason. I just always been the color scheme. Yeah, I don't know. That's a really good question. Basketball, I've just never had a team. I mean, after the Hornets disbanded and left, I refused to be a Bobcat fan.
Yeah. Yeah, I was a Pistons fan growing up. I don't know why.
That's interesting.
No particular reason.
I was a Bulls fan growing up, but...
Probably because I don't pay that much to the NBA. It's just, as you get older, you have so many other things vying for your time. Like, I'm fully invested in state sports. That's about all I got. And then, like you said, I think fantasy has been great for the NFL and what, you know, it's the what it's exposed them to. But at the same time, like you said, I'm more invested in the players and that. I really don't really care too much about the teams. I think that's probably a very universal feeling. I think you're either like hardcore team player or you're a fantasy guy and you just don't care. You just want all of them.
You know, it's interesting because it at least gives you, you know, if you're like a Panthers fan, then you're really looking forward to just one game, right? But when you're following all the different players and, you know, rooting for specific things, I don't know. To me, it was, I had the most fun this last year actually watching the NFL because I was just kind of constantly jumping back and forth. You know, it's not because of Mahomes. I always really like the Chiefs as well. For some reason, I used to always play as them in on my SNES and in Madden. I don't know why. And I became really obsessed with them. So I'm going to say Chiefs right now. I'm just going to ride it, and I'll be called a bandwagon fan, and that's fine.
Something I wanted to mention too, unrelated, but I saw it come across Twitter the other day. State has an esports team, and I was surprised about it. So I started messaging with Camden from the Technician. He covers it. That State had just beaten Carolina in some Overwatch match. And so he sent me some info, and I'm going to start like relaying it as I can, because I think it's interesting. I didn't know we had a team, but he said, Overwatch, I know they've been ranked as high as 8 last semester. I've been talking to Jay Bate, who plays in the team. He seems to be doing the scheduling. They're competing in an online college league every week, and they can work their way through to regionals and nationals that way. Then they do – there's League of Legends. They have regionals and nationals. I'm trying to think. If they make nationals, they get flown out to L.A. to compete in a Riot Games LOL Arena.
What is Overwatch?
They're competing for scholarship.
What is Overwatch? I've never actually seen any gameplay.
Oh, dude, Overwatch is so fun. We played it for – I used to play it for quite a while until Apex Legends came out. But it's a 6-on-6 game.
And I'm guessing it's just a shooter or –
Yeah, it's a shooter game. I'm trying to think of how to explain it. There's typically it's like one team is defending one side, and you're trying to capture.
Is it a little bit like Counter-Strike, or it looks a little different?
Not really. It's more, I want to say more cartoony. That's probably a bad way to describe it. But it's like, yeah, I don't know. It's hard to describe, but it's a lot of fun. It was chaos watching it when my buddy said, hey, we should try this game. It's coming out. And he sent me a video. I was like, dude, that looks like madness.
Can you like but see through walls or something?
It's a lot of fun. Yeah, there's different guys have different abilities. It's more like it's like comic book type heroes, but they're not.
I got you.
Real comic book heroes, if that makes sense. It's a super fun game. And it's been out for a while now. They're on doing seasons and whatnot, but I'm going to start getting more of the esports information. I think it's interesting. I want to give those guys some exposure. I just wanted to make sure I mentioned that. I forgot about it.
Just watching that video is giving me anxiety.
It's mad. You can't watch the video and like understand what's going on until you play it. And you're like, okay, this is not as crazy as it looks. Yeah. That's how I felt.
Oh my gosh.
Quentin asks, what's y'all's favorite fish? Saltwater and freshwater, one for each. This is an easy one for me. Freshwater, largemouth bass, baby.
I was going to say, is this catching or eating?
Catching them. Okay. I don't know. He didn't specify. I love bass fishing.
Did you say, are you largemouth or smallmouth?
In my opinion.
The easier
largemouth.
Two.
I love it. Oh, dude, my pond out behind my house is still, and I just sitting here thinking about throwing a topwater out there and just watching the bass just destroy it. Oh, it's nothing better, man. It's awesome. Saltwater, probably tuna. I mean, eating wise, I think it's fantastic. We went deep sea fishing one time and caught some bluefin, and this bluefin hit the line so hard it like twisted the rod and it bent the rod holder, and that rod holder is like 4-inch steel, man. And we were reeling it in. It took like an hour to reel him in, and as he gets close to the boat, he's doing a little death spiral, right? And they swim around in circles, and there's 5 or 6 others with him just doing the same thing, like follow him up. I was like, oh my god. And it was 200 pound bluefin tuna. We get back to the dock, and the captain comes out and just starts cutting it up. And he's like, here. And I'm like, what am I supposed to do with this? He's like, eat it. And it was so good. It was like I had this tuna loin fresh out of the ocean that's at least, I don't know, I'm thinking like 3 feet long. And you could just pull it off like butter and eat it. Man, it was so good. So I'm going to go with tuna and
okay, those are good choices. Man, freshwater. My favorite fish to catch freshwater is northern pike. We used to go up to Canada every summer. I think, yeah, we used to go up to northern Ontario and fish there for a week. And so we were, my dad was focused on walleyes. He really likes catching walleye, and walleye is really good to eat. But to me, the northern pike is the best. It's an aggressive predator fish. They're fun to kind of stalk after, and I've always wanted to catch one on the fly, and I never got an opportunity. But let's see, saltwater. I don't know. Are we going to count striped bass as saltwater? Because I love it.
Somebody actually mentioned that. Yeah, somebody responded to him and said that.
The only reason I say that is because when they run up the James here, it's so exciting to catch them.
Yeah.
I didn't. We went deep sea for them, or not even deep sea really, but we went out into the Chesapeake Bay and we were just hauling them in. And it wasn't even like fishing; it was just like you were just reeling, which just wasn't as fun to me. Let me think if there's any other saltwater fish that I really have enjoyed. That's probably the most recent, so I'm going to go with that. Eating wise, yeah, you're right. I mean, about largemouth bass, just thinking about it. So every summer we do this guy's weekend, and this last year we went to this private ranch in outside of Dallas, and they have a pond there, and it's fully stocked with largemouth bass and tilapia. I guess the tilapia help control the grime or whatever in the pond. But they're basically like virgin largemouth bass. And I mean, I got so tired of catching them. Like it really was like shooting fish in a barrel, but it is super fun when you get them on some light tackle, and man, they're fun. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah. It's about the same out here. I go out in my pond and I'm the only one that fishes it. And I go out there with some light tackle and you just slay the bass, man. It's awesome. I'm pretty sure last year I caught the same bass like 3 or 4 times because he was huge. And it can't be that many big fish in this relatively small pond. But he was the size of like my knee down to my leg. And I'm, 6'1", 6'2". Like, so it was a bass fish.
Are you throwing – are you throwing poppers or are you throwing, what are you going for?
Yeah, I like the popper. I throw a lot of Zara spooks.
Those spooks are great.
Crawlers across. I've never been big on buzz baits.
You gotta do the chatter bait.
For me.
It does work.
Yeah, I've tried a chatter bait. Not too great in this pond, I don't think. I need to go out to Harris Lake and run it, and then I use a lot of swimmers like jerk baits and things like that. The jerk baits work real well. The soft jerks, they I don't know how you don't bite them if you're a fish. It looks so good coming through the water. It's like eat me. Yeah, love it. Good question. That's an interesting one. I love fishing. I do want to go out. Like, one of the things I've always wanted to do is go out to Wyoming or Montana.
Oh, you gotta do it.
Sit in a stream and go fly fishing.
I think about it all the time. If you do it, go out there, just get a guide. Do a stream walk the first time, and then do a float a day or two later, and really, really see the area. I really recommend it to anybody. Yeah. Big Sky, Montana, man. We had a great time out there.
Man, I'm jealous. You've been
doing
all the things that I wanted to do.
That's who I am. You went to Thailand, and I was like, screw that, I'm going to Montana.
We asked for some YouTube channel recommendations and finally got some good ones. I wanted to point out one that I didn't know I needed, but I needed. James Crow pointed out, it's Cars and Water for some reason. But this guy takes his ball of nickel, like some metal ball of nickel, and he heats it up and then he puts it on things and just watches how they react. And it's just mesmerizing. I sat there and watched probably 20 minutes of this red ball of nickel melting watermelons and Nokia cell phones. And
what's it called?
It's so cool.
Cars.
It's called Cars and Water. Yeah. And seriously, it's just a red ball of nickel. And that's all it is. No talking. The guy just heats up this thing and puts it on stuff. You're like, this is wild. Yeah. Really strange. There's some really crazy stuff on YouTube, man.
Sorry, I'm just watching like the channel highlights.
Yeah, right? It's crazy. So good. So I appreciate it. That's why I want to keep asking, because there's so many out there that I don't know about. Like I would never found that.
Oh my gosh, that's interesting.
Yeah, there's a couple others. Mahesh said Dr. Mike. I watched a couple of his videos since he sent that. I thought it was pretty good. Pretty straightforward.
I was worried at first that was going to be like a crack science kind of doctor. Like, and us be like, ooh, Mahesh, you're going into medicine?
Uh-oh. let me check the other one. Hang on. There was one more. There's a lot of them. Yeah, that was one I wanted to. Those are two I wanted to point out. YouTube has channels. I am old. That was the other comment we got. Yeah. So keep them coming. I appreciate them. I'll share the links so everybody has them, because I think they're interesting. But that's all I got. Our shortest podcast ever.
I don't know.
Probably.
Let's end it now before it goes.
I was going to say, should I ask Will a political question?
Let him rant for another 20 minutes. I would not rant. But if someone needs to be talked off a ledge, I'll talk you off a ledge. Apparently, I've been having to do that. I was the internet's therapist today. Oh, man. Indeed. Oh, good Lord. Indeed.
People are crazy. Yeah. All right, folks. Thanks for listening. We'll talk to you some point after the weight game, probably before the ACC tournament.
Go Pack.
And that's it. Go Pack.